get to throw a lot of dirt. Despite a difference in racetracks and mechanics, the Jelly Lightning dirt car's appearance and success matched its 1970 8500 counterparts.
It's hard to describe because you never run the two of them on the same racetrack. Even if you run a Jelly Lightning dirt car on pavement, you only get a little, you know, quite a bit sideways. And the rear engine car drifted, but it's not very sideways. So there is a big difference in driving the car.
Not only was the success of 1970 Jelly Lightning dirt car marked by the spectacular rally of Unser, but now his chief again, George McDonald, is due to his credit for the impressive work.
George McDonald helped design the Jelly Lightning car. United King built the car. George told him how he wanted it. That would be the beginning.
He did really good.
After a 5-year absence from IndyCar racing, Unser Jr. teamed up with fellow New Mexican Rick Gallus and returned to the track in 2000 with a number 3 Stars car.
The Stars car that you're looking at was owned by Rick Gallus.
Al and I got back together in 2000. We'd been separated. He'd gone his way with Roger Penske, and we were really excited to get back. He was coming back to Indianapolis, and Stars was going to sponsor the company along with a company named tickets.com, and later it became a Stars car along with Budweiser, who came on as a sponsor.
We were back running the Indy 500. It was a very good time in my life because I was back racing where I truly loved to race.
He was a lot different because he was older, more mature. We won 2 races. Our last race we won together was in St. Louis, which was Budweiser's hometown. And that was a lot of fun because it was a complete team victory.
that day we had a fast car. Towards the end of the race, there was a yellow. Rick Gallus took a gamble, made our pit. We built it up the fuel, put four tires on. The gamble was that we had to lean the engine down and fuel to make it to the end of the race. Anytime you lean the engine down, you run slower. Al wasn't very happy at that particular time. But then towards the end of the race, we were running lean. Everybody else had to pit. So when they pitted, we went right to the front. Then he was happy.
And it was fun having Al back because we'd had him early in his career and now we were getting him later in his career. It was a lot of fun for both of us to be reunited.
Upon his return to racing, Al Jr. found that the IRL had changed the structure and design of IndyCars, but he discovered a means to once again contend with the best through his Stars car.
Cylinder streamline.
Look at the way. hikes were made. Oh my God, look at the seat.
Mm-hmm. No, that's a comfortable seat.
Yeah. Indian twin original motor. Wow. And then that one over there, 1914 Eagle twin. Wow. So 1913 Yale.
4 horsepower and a top speed of 40 miles an hour.
1911 Harley Davidson.
Transmission was a leather belt with a pulley tensioner clutch.
Oh, yeah.
It sold in 1911 for
$300.
Wow.
Wow.
That's a lot of money.
It's also known as the Silent Gray Fellow.
But you look at the craftsmanship on them,
mm-hmm.
You know.
Moped back on the day.
Yeah.
Engine.
And then we went back because I had the conversation with
the Offenhauser 68, 159 turbo. Cosworth right there. That's...
This one right here is the Cosworth. Okay. 2.65 liter. And then you have the Chevrolet 2.5 liter V6.
That was in the IROC cars? Like the RFA? The Ford? IMSA GTO series.
Oh, IMSA. Okay.
Is it IWASH? Oh, Chevy turbocharged V8, this one. And then the Chevrolet 3.5 liter V8. For the advice for the Indianapolis 500 and for the IRL series starting in 1997. Mandating use of the 4 liter production based engines with no turbochargers. Most teams chose a 700 horsepower V8 engine developed by General Motors, which was bad as an Oldsmobile. Hey guys, okay. So we're here at the Unser Racing Museum in Albuquerque, New Mexico. We just finished one building and now we're heading over to our second building. And it's pretty cool. Hope you enjoy the videos. And just about ready to go in. So see you inside. Bye.
He bought that as a present to himself.
Mm-hmm.
For winning the national championship in 1990. As you can see by all the chrome, highly customized. It's also turbocharged.
Of course it is.
No boys in our toys.
That's a nice paint job, too.
This portion of the museum opened March 2010, about 5 years after the front building. Prior to this portion of the museum opening, everything you see behind that glass wall was stored in the handball court of all places.
Oh.
It wasn't available for public viewing. This side of the room is IndyCar trophies and awards. The far side is Pikes Peak and Dirt Track. There in the jewelry case, those were the Unser's qualifying rings. Every driver that qualifies for the Indy 500 is given a ring, and their qualifying speed is engraved in the ring.
Mm-hmm.
Al Juniors are on the right, Al's are on the left. We have three more of the Unser's pace cars in here. The Unser's always had it written in the contract with the team they were driving for, that if they won the race, they got to keep the pace car. The Chrysler LeBaron story is a little bit different in that when Al went to collect the car, they were very reluctant to give it to him. They said Al's car is highly modified for its pace car duties. It's no longer street legal. You can't license it. You know, why do you want it? What plan on putting it in my museum, he tells them. Well, he had no idea of this. I said, Al, that's wonderful. How many cars do you currently have in your museum? He said, oh, about 200. He was referring to the inventory at his wrecking yard.
Oh, okay.
That's the museum. The black Corvette has been number two. It has less than 400 miles on it. VIN number one is in the museum at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. There's only one vehicle in this room that is not capable of running. Everything else is. The 1923 Sterling truck at the back of the room, that belonged to Al's neighbor. Al tried to buy it from the neighbor for years, and the neighbor would always say, "I'll never ever sell you that truck."
Yeah.
Well, the reason for the neighbor's attitude, he and Al were competitors in business. Mm-hmm. Well, to make matters worse, the neighbor moved the truck and parked it along the fence between their two properties. So Al got to look at it rotting away every day. Well, the neighbor died. And Al was able to acquire the truck, and he restored it. That truck used to make deliveries between Albuquerque and Santa Fe.
Oh, really?
Its top speed's about 25 miles an hour. In the far back corner, you'll see automotive diagnostic equipment, machinist type equipment. That's all equipment out of Jerry's garage. So that'll turn you guys loose and enjoy.
Oh, thank you.
Perfect. Thank you.
Thank you for coming. Where are you folks from?
Here. Originally, we live in California now.
There you go, California.
Corona. Corona. That's like Riverside. Half an hour from
Montana. From the track?
Yeah.
That works.
Holy crap.
Look at this thing.
It's just funny to think all this stuff. It's just freaking amazing.
Oh, it is.
So did anyone tell you the story about that concrete wall and catch fence?
Yeah, you just, yeah. Just told it all the way over here.
Yeah. It was down a little ways here in the archive room, and you'll see some busted up wheels laying on the floor. Those were on Al Jr.'s car when he hit the wall.
Oh.
Maurice LaCroix watches.
What a nice. For winning the race?
Awards.
This room is just amazing. Look at all of those.
Belongs to Al Jr.
Oh my
Lord. It's had quite the history. At one point it was stolen.
Yeah.
And it was recovered.
Yeah.
It applies to trophies.
Yeah. Bombardier 500.
Texas Motor Speedway.
Sure they filled that with champagne. Most racing drivers probably have, you know, one shelf or two.
Well, they had a grand opening of this part of the museum. Ari Leindike showed up.
Oh, okay.
And he was showing us pictures of his.
How many trophies are actually in there?
Champagne in that one.
Bobby's a very aggressive guy.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's nothing you should be surprised at. I mean, that's your family-driven heritage. You're going to win.
Well, you don't win on the first lap.
No. And with a bunch of, how old? Well, I was probably 16. I think he was like 12. But, Well, I was 62. I think he was born in 68. Yeah, so he's like 6 years younger. He's a little kid, freaking just. Of course, you know.
Well, not, none of them are very good. Behind you is the Top Dog Award, and that's from the Hoosier 100. Alan won that race 3 years in a row, and he asked for the trophy, and they said, "No, sorry, Alan, the trophy stays at the track." He says, "Okay, I'm coming back next year. I'm winning the race, and I'm taking the trophy." And that's exactly what he did.
Oh, okay.
Well, so if you look at the, three times, it's like, hey, three strikes, it's mine.
The Navy allowed him a race while he was on the islands. The locals didn't like it much because he won nearly every race he entered.
You couldn't match the cool factor.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it rode like a tank.
So I learned watching their videos with the little wheels that they have back here that they can move them up and down so when they make their turns. They believe it, if it's flat, they go faster, but it's hard for them to turn. And if it's slightly elevated, then they can make the turns, but they don't go very fast on a straightaway. So these wings move up and down.
So why should it buy these new rubber tires? Despite their inadequacies, trucks were catching on. At the outset of World War I, the British and French armies contracted American manufacturers such as FWD and White Williams to build trucks for their war. U.S. trucks would soon have been rescued from this disaster. Something had to be done. The solution came from the aforementioned engine's extremely accurate for its durability and performance in rough terrain.
So we heard him tell us a little bit of the story about this.
Trucks were able to prove themselves to the American public that they were capable of carrying heavy loads under very difficult conditions. American manufacturers were looking to cash in on the truck's newfound acceptance. For the Goodyear Tire Company, this meant finally selling the public on improved pneumatic tires. In 1918, to show the product's superiority, they outfitted 7 trucks with the new tires and set them loose on America's roads. Pneumatic tires allowed for increased speed and better traction off-road, which was important because the American road system was poorly developed. City roads were well established, but an organized interconnecting highway system had never been necessary. The roads that connected cities and states were little more than dirt paths, if they existed at all. Trucks would bounce off the treacherous roads or smash through bridges built to handle horse traffic.
Road conditions and tires are what limited their size.
1930 Ford Model A delivery wagon. Bud Rice, a resident of Budvale, New Mexico, located on Old Route 66, just east of Grants, presented this panel delivery wagon to Al Unser in 1968. Bud and Al both had towing service businesses in the 1960s and had visited each other's wrecking yards. Al always said to Bud, "If you ever want to sell that old Model A, let me know." To which Bud would always reply, "It isn't for sale." Not long before Bud passed away, he appeared at Al's shop and said, "Here's your darn Model A." This began Al's 30-year hobby of appreciating, collecting, and restoring Model A's. That is funny. So this is stuff that's taken from Jerry's garage. Green one?
I like his choice of colors.
Yeah.
I love that color.
I like the blue behind me, yeah.
Yeah, that's because all his trucks seem to be that color.
I really like that. That one kind of looks like a hearse. The blue one looks like a hearse because of the way it opens in the back.
That's a delivery bag.
Yeah, I know. It was a delivery, yeah. But yeah, no, I like this green one. Is it green or teal, huh?
Teal.
And it's...
That one's green.
Oh, that one over there is teal. Okay. Wow, look at this one. It reminds me of a Bonnie and Clyde vehicle. Sorry about the glare. So this vehicle here is a 1930 Oldsmobile Deluxe. This one kind of looks the same. Oh, that one's a little square up on the top than this one. This was a 1929 Model A four-door, it says. And of course we have these over here, like these. Like I believe they call that a rumble seat. Look how they put the little stuffed animals in there. This one is a 1930 Model A Sport Coupe. In the era of the horse-drawn carriages, servants were seated behind the body in what was called the rumble-tumble seat. Prior to World War II, the seat was referred to as the mother-in-law seat. And pre-World II Model A Roadster, Coupe, and Cabriolet body styles offered either a rumble seat or a luggage compartment on the deck. As cars became faster and more streamlined, the popularity of the rumble seat diminished. Let's see, this one is 1929 Ford Model A Coupe. The Model A engine was a water-cooled L-head four-cylinder with a displacement of 201 cubic inches that produced 40 HPs. Horsepower. Oh, I like these. Like the little trucks. Oh my God, look at Raggedy Ann and Andy. This is beautiful. This one? I know. You see the Raggedy Ann and Andy in it?
Yeah.
Yeah, I like that. 1936 Ford model.
1930.
Oh, 1934.
If you'd noticed, there's a few of the 1930s. The panel van was a 1930.
Yeah.
The other ones over there is a 1930s.
I like the rumble seat.
Yeah. I believe there was one more. There was a coupe. It's a 29.
What this say? It says, okay, so this one, somewhere between the Texas Motor Speedway and the Texas State Line, Al Unser Jr. spotted this pickup sitting in a field with a for sale sign. He had just finished a 500 mile race and was on his way home to Albuquerque. The pickup sat in his father's garage in pieces with promises of one day restoring it, perhaps to drive around town. In 2010, Al Sr. gathered up the pieces and called his good friend Dale, was that Mule Hoarder, in Apache Junction, Arizona, to see if he would like a project. Dale completed the frame-up restoration in 9 months, and upon delivery to the museum, it was fired up and driven until it had emptied its tank of gas. Ooh. 1946 Chevrolet Business Coupe.
Hold it there for 10 seconds.
Yeah. I've been doing some of that. Let me get this. There we go. 1941 Chevrolet pickup.